Today, we're going to be talking about the importance of diagnosis and screening of colorectal cancer, and more importantly, what can we all do to prevent getting colorectal cancer. So we're going to start off with just some basics about colorectal cancer, what it is, where does it come from, what are the signs and symptoms, what are the risk factors that we can and can't change, what can we do to prevent or mitigate those risk factors, what can we do to screen for colon cancer, and most importantly, some details about colonoscopy. So the colon is synonymous with the large intestine, starts off in the right lower quadrant with the cecum. We often refer to this part as the ascending colon, transverse colon, descending sigmoid colon. The rectum is slightly a different entity that we handle slightly differently than cancers throughout the other parts of the colon. One important physiologic function of the colon is reclamation of water. When the fecal stream enters the colon from the small intestine, it's pure liquid, and as it traverses around the colon, water is reclaimed from the fecal stream until it's solidified in a solid stool and evacuated. So the entire colon is lined with epithelium, mucosal epithelium. There's glandular tissue in that epithelium. When there are abnormalities in the cell signaling pathways that regulate cell growth, then we can get hyperproliferation, overgrowth of this glandular epithelial tissue. That can lead to adenomatous polyps. Those are the particular kind of polyps we're worried about. There are other kinds of polyps we sometimes find in the colon. The one we hear about most commonly is hyperplastic polyps. Those have zero malignant potential. They can never lead to cancer, so those are considered normal incidental findings. What we're worried about are adenomatous polyps. As these polyps grow in size, they can they grow into the lumen of the colon sometimes. They can be somewhat flat, start out flat or sessile. They can grow in sort of a mushroom shape, what we call pedunculated polyps. And as they increase in size, and as they've been there for a longer time, the individual cells within the polyps start to become abnormal, what we call dysplasia. That dysplasia is a precursor to cancer. As the cancer grows, it starts to increase in malignant and invasive potential and potential to spread to other parts of the body. This is what they often look like on colonoscopy. Here we have a round, sort of flat polyp. This is what one of these pedunculated polyps often looks like. And as the tumor grows in size, as I was saying, the ability of the tumor and its propensity to spread increases. It starts to spread to the lymph nodes that are in the leaflet, the mesentery that drains the colon. And from there, they can spread throughout the body to the liver, to the lungs. But the good news is that overall, colorectal cancer is highly curable. The survival is directly related to the stage and how early it's found. With early stage tumors, and I think Alex will be talking more about this, but the T stage refers to the size of the actual mass at the time of diagnosis. And it goes from 1 to 4. And with early stage tumors, the survival rate is 90%. Even with advanced stage tumors, the 5-year survival rate is as high as 70%. Even with nodal disease, we have a very good survival rate. So it really brings home the point that early detection, finding these colorectal cancers in the earlier stages, is really important. So knowing that, what should you watch for? What should you be concerned about? You know, there are the classic symptoms that we need to be concerned about that indicate there could be a problem in the colon. Blood and stool is the most common or concerning finding. As stool passes by polyps or premalignant growths, it can induce bleeding that can show up as blood in the stool. Blood mixed with the stool, blood in the toilet bowl, blood in the toilet paper. A lot of times, blood in the toilet paper can result from hemorrhoids, but you should never just write it off as being from hemorrhoids. That's one of the key things that should always get checked out. There are other less common symptoms which can result from colon cancer, worsening constipation or decreased caliber of the stool from a tumor impinging on the lumen of the colon, inability to completely evacuate, in advanced cases, unexplained weight loss, anemia, fatigue from chronic blood loss with the tumor. But the most important sign or symptom of colon cancer is none. Most early colon cancers are asymptomatic. Most patients have no sign or symptom of it until it becomes more advanced. Over 80% of colorectal cancers arise from polyps, which most are asymptomatic. So screening is really important. Adenomatous polyps typically have a slow progression from the time they start to when they develop invasive cancer. That can be anywhere from 10 to 15 years in some cases. So early colorectal cancer screening is very important because we can find and detect early polyps and early malignancies through routine screening before they progress to an advanced stage. So there's definite risk factors for developing colorectal cancer. Family history, specific genetic syndromes, inflammatory bowel disease such as Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. There are age and lifestyle factors, and there are preventative measures that we can all do to mitigate some of these risk factors. But most importantly, a high percentage, 75 to 95% of colorectal cancers have no genetic risk. Familial risk is an important factor. That accounts for about 20% of new colorectal cancer cases. And this is separate from what we call genetic syndromes. And we identify familial risk by other people in our family who've had colorectal cancer. So the distinction is if you have a first-degree relative, a parent or a sibling that was diagnosed with colon cancer before age 60, two or more first-degree relatives diagnosed with colorectal cancer or adenomatous polyps at any age, and there's a definite increase in your individual risk of developing colon cancer, a 2 to 3-fold increased risk of developing colorectal cancer. And for those people that have an increased familial risk, there are specific screening guidelines. There are very specific genetic syndromes that have a high risk of developing colorectal cancer. These are very well-defined genetic syndromes that have very specific inheritance patterns. They're usually well-recognized within families, but they account for a very small percentage of colorectal cancer cases. Hereditary non-polyposis colon cancer syndrome, which is previously known as Lynch syndrome, is a readily identifiable pattern of inheritance of a specific genetic mutation that's passed down in families where individuals develop colon cancer at an early age. Usually it's diagnosed in their 40s, and it's usually well known. Familial adenomatous polyposis syndrome and Gardner syndrome are both syndromes with a definite inheritance pattern, and patients develop numerous, we're talking hundreds of polyps throughout their colon. These patients develop colon cancer at an early age, and usually end up having a total colectomy because there's such a high incidence of progression of colon cancer. So these usually, if one of these exists in your family, it's known. It's not something that we have to worry about in general. Usually it's known and it's well recognized. Inflammatory bowel disease, and we're specifically talking about Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis, are specific diseases that carry with them an increased risk of developing colorectal cancer. These are immune-mediated inflammatory diseases involving the colon and or also the small intestine. Not to be confused with irritable bowel syndrome, this is inflammatory bowel disease, which is specifically Crohn's and ulcerative colitis. There's a high risk of developing colorectal cancer for these patients. Most of these patients are diagnosed for other reasons than a colorectal cancer because of the symptoms that are associated with the specific diseases. When they're diagnosed, then we start talking about the increased risk of colorectal cancer and the different screening methods and guidelines for those patients. But the risk is significant. Up to 18% of patients in these categories will develop colorectal cancer at a time of 30 years of having the disease. And it's important to know that it's not 18. When we talk about these numbers about chance and percent, it's incidence. It doesn't mean that it's a chance. It means 18 out of 100 will develop it. But besides the increased prevalence of colorectal cancer among these patients, it's also increased mortality. It's more lethal. Well, besides familial risk, genetic risk, again, most of these have no genetic risk. So what is it? Well, there's definitely increased incidence of both adenomatous polyps and the development of invasive cancer as our age advances. That we can't do anything about. Diet has been definitely shown there's been some association with certain dietary intakes. I'm going to let Melanie talk more about that, whether it's processed red meats, smoked meats, and other types of meat that cause an increased incidence of polyp formation and colon cancer. Excessive alcohol intake on a regular basis has been shown to increase risk of colon cancer, and studies have shown that more than one drink per day can increase your risk of developing colorectal cancer. Smoking has a clear association with colorectal cancer. Exercise has been shown to diminish your risk of colon cancer. People with a sedentary lifestyle have an increased risk of developing colon cancer. High-intensity exercise on a regular basis can decrease your risk of developing colon cancer by as much as 21%. Water intake, not getting enough water has been shown to increase your risk of colon cancer. Drinking at least 5 glasses of water per day has been shown to decrease your risk. And weight control. Obese patients have been shown to have an increased risk and prevalence of colon cancer. And maintaining a normal body weight has been shown to decrease your risk of developing colon cancer. Other preventative measures. And this is an interesting one that we don't really know all the details, but aspirin and other certain non-steroidal anti-inflammatories appear to reduce the risk of colorectal cancer in high-risk patients. And this is a very cautious recommendation. It's not one that should just be undertaken without talking to your doctor first, because both aspirin and other non-steroidals carry a risk of gastrointestinal bleeding, and some medications such as Celebrex can increase your risk of a cardiovascular event. So it's a very specific recommendation whether or not someone should do aspirin and or some other non-steroidal anti-inflammatory for the purpose of preventing or reducing risk of colon cancer. Finally, vitamin D has been shown to possibly have a beneficial role. Maintaining a normal vitamin D level or requiring vitamin D supplementation can have a beneficial effect. But the most important preventative measure is screening. There are a number of different methods we use for screening, and we divide patients into average risk and high risk. One time I told them, well, you're average risk, and they got offended by it. I said, well, why aren't I low risk? Well, there's only average, normal risk, and high risk. That's it. So, and based on those, there are definite recommendations for average risk individuals, high risk individuals. There are specific considerations for insurance coverage and Medicare guidelines. So there's a number of screening methods. These top three here, fecal occult blood testing, fecal immunochemical testing, and the multi-target stool DNA test, also known as the Cologuard, are tests that they're non-invasive tests. A stool sample is taken, either done in the doctor's office with a digital rectal examination in the anal canal and in the rectal vault to retrieve some stool, or done at home to swipe the stool. It's put on a card, then usually either mailed in or sent in. The fecal occult blood test just tests for blood in the stool. The immunochemical test is a more advanced immunochemical reaction to detect blood in the stool. And the multi-target stool DNA test is a very specialized test, which as cells are shed from the lining of the colon and shed from the area of the precancerous or lesions or adenomatous polyps, they can detect genetic alterations in those cells that are shed. None of these are a substitute for regular routine screening according to one of these methods. Dual contrast barium enema is a radiology test that's done as an outpatient where air and contrast is inserted into the colon, then x-rays are performed so that we see abnormalities or defects where the contrast doesn't fill the colon. Flexible sigmoidoscopy is an endoscopic procedure that's done as an outpatient procedure, sometimes in the doctor's office, which only examines the left part of the colon. So it's a limited exam, doesn't examine the entire colon. Virtual colonoscopy is a newer. It's been around for several years. It's also referred to as CT colonography, where patients do a bowel prep. Then they have the colon insufflated with air, and they go through a CT scanner. There are limitations to virtual colonoscopy. The size that, of the polyps that can be detected is limited down to about 5 or 6 millimeters. And of course, if something is detected on the virtual colonoscopy, then you have to have another procedure in order to remove or biopsy that, whatever that finding is. There's additional radiation exposure with the CT colonography. And normally we reserve virtual colonoscopy for patients who can't undergo a colonoscopy for some other reason. Either they have something medically prohibitive for them undergoing colonoscopy, or there's some reason we can't do, there's a problem with the colon that we can't do a colonoscopy. So it's not a first-line recommendation, it's a backup. There are well-developed screening guidelines starting back to the American Cancer Society in 1980. There have been a number of multi-group task forces that have put together screening guidelines. We have very good consensus screening guidelines now that are well-recognized. But despite all these screening guidelines and despite how important we know screening is, our compliance is very poor. In the U.S., only 59% of adults 50 or older have been screened according to appropriate guidelines. So when we look at what the screening guidelines are, when we talk about average risk individuals, people with no increased risk, no family history, no predisposition, everybody should at least begin at age 50. The screening guidelines recommend an annual fecal occult blood test or a Cologuard test every 3 years and a colonoscopy every 10 years. Flexible sigmoidoscopy, barium enema, virtual colonoscopy are considered as alternatives, again, not first line, and those require increased frequency. If we find anything at the initial colonoscopy, then that determines, if we find polyps according to how many, what size, what kind, that determines what interval follow-up we recommend, whether it's 1, 3, or 5 years, depending on what kind of polyps we find. Now, for those of increased risk, generally the key is beginning at age 40. So for people who have a history of colorectal cancer or adenomatous polyps in one relative before age 60, or any two relatives at any age, they fall into this group. They should begin at age 40 and be screened every 5 years. For people who have colorectal cancer in one relative over age 60, they should begin at 40 but continue every 10 years. So the big difference is what age your relatives were and how many. It's important to note, and a lot of people aren't aware of this, that there is a special coverage benefit for colorectal cancer screening mandated by the Affordable Care Act. It is a no-cost sharing benefit for the patient. So colorectal cancer screening, and in particular colonoscopy, are covered at no cost to the patient. No deductible, no copay, no co-insurance. It's a special benefit carved out according to the Affordable Care Act. It was mandated as of September 23, 2010. So most plans cover that. They're in compliance. Some plans that were started before that date are grandfathered in and don't have to comply with that, that mandate, but most do anyway. And it's a rare exception that we ever encounter a private insurance plan that does not comply with that mandated benefit. Medicare covers is in line with that. It will cover a screening colonoscopy every 10 years for average risk individuals and every 2 years for high risk individuals, which is even more common than some of the guidelines recommend. All right, so let's talk about colonoscopy then. Colonoscopy is by far the standard which all the other screening methods are judged against. Colonoscopy has the potential to reduce the number of colorectal cancer screening deaths by as much as 60%. It's done at an outpatient facility, such as the hospital or freestanding ambulatory surgery center. Of course, we do this under IV sedation. Patients say it's a very pleasant nap. Having had an upper endoscopy myself, I can attest to it. You go to sleep and you wake up in the recovery room and it's like, what happened? And that's usually the first thing most patients ask. Well, when are we going to start? And, oh, can I get some of that medicine to go also? It does involve a cleansing prep, as do all the other screening guidelines, whether it's screening methods, whether it's barium enema, virtual colonoscopy. This is the hard part. And the preps we have now are better. That's a relative term. Doesn't mean good, but they're better. But most importantly, colonoscopy is very important because With colonoscopy, we have the ability not only find small polyps down to a millimeter in size, but we can remove these polyps before they ever have the chance to progress to larger polyps, develop dysplasia, or proceed to cancer. So, in conclusion, your genes are your genes. Your family are your family. Can't change that. But you should be aware of symptoms, and you should be aware of the screening guidelines. And remember that being early, being proactive, finding polyps and cancers at an early stage can save your life. Thank you all. Yes, go ahead.
When you mentioned the aspirin, what dose would you suggest?
Well, that's a very specialized recommendation, and it also depends on your other conditions. And usually a baby aspirin will be recommended based on your other conditions. So generally it's a baby aspirin.
But in most cases, that dose is enough to be therapeutic?
Is beneficial,
okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Hello, I'm Alec Urquhart. I'm the medical oncologist at the Cancer Center, and I've been here about, as Michael told you, about 10 years now. So I was going to talk a little bit about treatment, a little bit about prevention, although I think John covered a bunch of those things, and we can talk a little bit about the aspirin some more, too, and things. But I really would talk about treatment of the breast cancer. Colon cancer. And, sorry, we had breast cancer clinic this morning, so I rushed over here from that. So, but really to talk about treatment of the colon cancer. Now, what we hope is that everybody goes and gets their screening, and Dr. Schultz, cuts all those polyps out, and no one ever gets the colon cancer. But in the situations where we do find colon cancer, I was going to go through the treatment and how we manage that. And just to kind of give you a brief overview, we're going to talk a little bit about definitions and anatomy, although John did touch base on that. And then staging, because that really dictates our treatment, is really the stage of the cancer. And we'll go through the treatment based upon the different stages, not try to overwhelm you too much. I will speak a little bit about rectal cancer. The most distal, the end of the colon, basically, is how I think about it as a non-surgeon. But it's biologically, in a lot of ways, behaves like colon cancer, although there are some key components about it that that lead to us treating it a little bit differently. And so I'll touch on that a little bit. And then also spend some time talking about stage 4 or metastatic colorectal cancer. And then maybe talk a little bit about prevention, although a lot of those things that John already spoke with and Mel will be telling us to eat lots of healthy things. So just to go through the anatomy and a little bit of background, I think some of this Dr. Schultz talked to you about. Colon cancer, I mean, everybody, we do a cancer talk, we always have to talk numbers, but about over 135,000 patients will be diagnosed with colon cancer per year in the U.S., about 70% of those are in the colon, and another 30% in the rectum. And each year, though, 50,000 patients die, or at least per year, not per yay, per year in the U.S. of colorectal cancer. And when we're talking about colon cancer, we're really talking about adenocarcinoma of the colon. That meaning that the most common cancer in the colon is adenocarcinoma. There are other cancers that can occur in the colon, things like stromal tumors and neuroendocrine tumors, but we really don't lump, those are treated very differently. They're not, when you talk about colon cancer, we're really talking about adenocarcinoma. So I think John had this slide, but we're basically talking about the large intestine as and the cancer is there. And when we're talking about the cancer, I think John had a great slide showing that, it's how we think of the pathogenesis of colon cancer, starting from abnormal cells that develop in the lining inside the large intestine. The large intestine is a big tube, absorbs water out of the stool, and where the cancers we think start are in this, the innermost lining, the mucosa there. And you start with some abnormal cells. They develop genetic mutations, and then accumulate additional mutations till they start doing things they shouldn't do, growing when they shouldn't grow, not dying when they should die, and then significantly starting to go places they don't belong. As that transitions from, you know, some dysplasia or abnormal cells or a carcinoma in situ, it can turn into an invasive cancer where it starts to invade into the layers of the intestine. And that's, and then once it's made that invaded into these other layers, it becomes an invasive cancer. And that's a key thing, because then it has the potential to spread, get into the bloodstream, but also get into the lymphatics through the lymph nodes and spread distantly to the liver, lungs, and elsewhere. So that's the big issue about cancer. Now, when we talk about diagnosis, typically, you know, I see the patient after they've had their colonoscopy, whether they presented with symptoms, an iron deficiency anemia, or were having abdominal complaints, and they had a colonoscopy and found a tumor, or hopefully if they've had a screening colonoscopy and they found an early stage tumor. And based upon that biopsy, we'll then go step forward to help plan the next steps in their management. And typically this includes staging, which part of that is doing blood work to assess their blood counts. Sometimes we'll do a marker, a protein level in the blood. But often we also do a CAT scan of the chest, abdomen, pelvis, which is the primary goal there is to make sure that those tumor cells haven't spread outside of the neighborhood of the colon, whether that's the lymph nodes. We think of the neighborhood as the colon and where the tumor started, but also then the lymph nodes that drain that area. That still is local regional disease. That's a disease that can potentially be cured with surgery. What you worry about, though, is if cancer cells have traveled outside of that neighborhood and gone to other places like the liver or lung or even bone and other places. The best way to evaluate for that is with imaging. Now, it takes a lot of cancer cells in order to show up on a scan. But what we want to do is make sure we don't see a mass in the liver, mass in the lungs. We often start with a CAT scan. That's still the standard. It gives us a good picture of the liver. It's good at looking at the lung, which are the most common places we will see spread of colorectal cancer. But then often we will supplement that with a PET CT scan if there's any question on the CAT scan. And basically we're looking for disease outside of the neighborhood. And this is a picture of a PET scan just to give us an idea of a patient. And he had a colon cancer that's here up in the splenic flexure, up in the high on the left side, but also in the PET showed a spot in the liver. And so this had shown evidence of the cancer's spread, and we think of as a stage 4 colon cancer. And I'll explain that here in a minute. But this is why we do these scans, is to help establish if there's been any spread. In general, just to kind of go through treatment, an overview of colon cancer, surgery is really the keystone of treatment of colorectal cancer. And this is especially true in early stage colon cancer. So, and many patients can be cured with just surgery alone. And so, and especially in stage 1, 2, and 3, a big part of the tumor treatment is removing the tumor with a colectomy, so removing the section of the tumor colon that has the tumor, but also removing the lymph nodes that drain that area. And it's important to get not just one or two lymph nodes, but to get 10, 12, sometimes 30 nodes. And Dr. Schultz could explain this better, but the whole idea is to get the nodes that drain that area. Then what I do, and it's been, is, you know, I'm a medical oncologist, so I really focus energies on medical therapy, which primarily is chemotherapy in the treatment of colon cancer. We do chemotherapy in different situations. It can be what we call adjuvant chemotherapy, which is the idea there is to give chemotherapy after surgery to help increase the chances a patient is cured. So we know in patients with stage 1 disease, many of those patients will be cured of their cancer just with surgery alone. But once you start to find cancer in the lymph nodes, so where the cancer has already spread to the lymph nodes in the neighborhood, we know the likelihood of the cancer recurring 1 year, 2 years, 5 years down the road is much higher. And then if we give chemotherapy in those patients, we can increase the chances that we cure their cancer by eradicating any microscopic cancer that may have escaped before their surgery. And I'll go through this again in more detail. But the other reason we give chemotherapy is that it's really the primary treatment in patients with stage 4 disease. So disease that's already spread to the liver or spread to the lung. And that can be quite effective at shrinking the tumor. And we'll talk a little bit more about that. Radiation can be used in the treatment of colon cancer. In colon cancer specifically, it plays a role more in the stage 4 setting or also for palliation. But it's also a key component of treatment of the rectal cancer. And I'll talk about that in a minute as well. So starting with stage 1, this is a diagram just to help us understand that. This is basically in the setting of a stage 1 cancer. You have a tumor that has developed in the lining. It started to invade into the submucosa, so the first layer of the intestine. It now has access to blood vessels, lymphatics, so it does have some potential to spread, but it's still pretty shallow. It hasn't, and these stage 1 cancers can be cured with surgery. And typically, if it's a pedunculated polyp, I don't know if you remember the picture that Dr. Schultz had of that pedunculated polyp that looked like a stem of broccoli sticking out in the colon. If that is excised at the time of the colonoscopy, some of those patients can be just observed without any further surgery. If there's any question, or in ones that aren't pedunculated like that one or in other situations, they'll undergo a hemicolectomy where they have part of that, that tumor removed, but also the lymph nodes removed. But that can be curative, and that's the only treatment they need is surgery. And we would then put them on, transition them to surveillance. And so that's what we hope for, because those patients, most of those patients will be cured with their surgery alone, do very well, and that's the goal behind sort of aggressive screening with colonoscopy. Stage 2, basically the idea there is that the cancer is bigger. It now is invaded deeper into the lining of the intestine. It can even get through the wall of the intestine, and even in T4, meaning that the tumor has grown through the wall and even maybe caused a perforation or of the intestine, or has spread to the tissues that may be next door and other sites. The difference here, the key thing here, is that there's no cancer in the lymph nodes. So stage 2 is at higher risk of spreading distantly than stage 1 because it has traveled deeper, it has more access to blood vessels and other things, but it hasn't gotten far enough where you actually see tumor in the lymph nodes. And so most of those patients will also be cured with surgery alone. And I think Dr. Schultz had some of those percentages in stage 2 disease. Many of those patients will be cured. The cure rates with surgery alone can be as high as 90%. If you start to have higher risk features, maybe where the tumor is invaded into other tissues, they're at higher risk of recurrence and start to drop down into the 70% range. Now, with stage 2, because there is a higher risk for distant recurrence, and when I say distant recurrence, I'm talking about distantly in the body, so meaning that it shows up somewhere outside of the neighborhood after their treatment, after their surgery, so it shows up in the lung or shows up in the liver 2 years down the road, 5 years down the road. That risk, is approximately 10%. It can be higher in different groups of patients. And for this reason, we will consider the adjuvant chemotherapy. And in the adjuvant chemotherapy is that chemotherapy we use to clean up, to sort of treat any microscopic disease that we can't see on any scan, but we know potentially is there. We know that because when we talk about the distant recurrence, when we talk about the cancer coming back, and really when we talk about people dying of colon cancer, what we're talking about is cancer showing up that escaped sometime before their surgery, before their cancer was removed, the primary cancer was removed, and it developed and started to grow and cause problems where it affected the liver function or caused pain or those kind of things. And if we give this chemotherapy, what we think we're doing is eradicating that microscopic disease that may have escaped sometime before surgery, and we know that that correlates with increase of cure. That, it reduces the risk of recurrence by somewhere around 40 to 60%. Now, in stage 2 disease, if your risk is 10 or 15%, you're reducing it by, you know, say half, you're dropping, you know, from 15% down to 7.5%, which that can be an important thing. Now, not all patients with stage 2 disease need chemotherapy. We know that there are some patients that seem to have a much higher risk of having recurrence. And the flip side is that there also seems to be patients that have a biologically more indolent or a slower growing tumor and seem to have a lower risk. And how we help to differentiate those patients, we can do that through certain risk factors. I talked about if it's, you know, grown through the wall of the tumor and into the other tissues, it's a higher risk. But there are even tests now that look at the genetics of their tumor, not necessarily the genetics a person is born with, but the genes that have gone bad within the cancer. You can test for those and help with the decision-making about whether a patient may benefit from adjuvant chemotherapy or not. Stage 3 colon cancer is a different ballgame. This is a cancer, you know, the cancer at this point in stage 3 really means that it's figured out how to get into those lymph nodes. We do subdivide it into different stage 3, A, B, or C. That really all depends on both the combination of the depth of invasion or the number of lymph nodes that are involved. And basically, and these are developed based upon that patients with different subtype, substage, will have a different prognosis. Stage 3, oops. Stage 3 has a much higher risk of recurrence, much higher risk of showing up down the road in their liver or lung, and we stage it that way just to help differentiate that and also help guide our treatment. In general, though, we tend to treat stage 3 very similarly. Surgery is still very important. Still have a hemicolectomy, still want to remove those regional lymph nodes. But we're much more strongly recommend that adjuvant chemotherapy after surgery. We know that there's a clear benefit in both reduction in risk of recurrence and, most importantly, an improvement in survival. If you take a bunch of patients with stage 3 disease and you don't give them any other treatment after surgery and then take another group and give them chemotherapy, there will be more patients alive in the group that received chemotherapy 5 years down the road. Than the group that did not receive chemotherapy. I mentioned earlier that we think that these chemotherapies reduce the risk of recurrence in, by close to 60% in some studies. And really the goal of this is to prevent systemic spread of the cancer. And really what we think we're doing is treating and eradicate any microscopic disease that may have spread sometime before their surgery. How we do this treatment, the standard regimens usually is to give treatment over a 6-month period. It's given as an intravenous treatment. There are different schedules. The most common one we give every 2 weeks for 12 treatments. They come in, receive their treatment. Actually, the one we commonly use that requires a pump where they wear for 2 days, but that's the cornerstone of treatment and it's been clearly shown to increase the cure rates. When Dr. Schultz showed you the percentage of nodal involvement, I don't know if the N1 or N3 disease, that's stage 3 cancer, 5-year survival can be in the 40% range, but we think chemotherapy can significantly improve that and hopefully bump that up from 40% up to, you know, higher up into the, you know, 60, 70 and a higher percent or higher. So that's really the rationale of treating stage 3 disease. I didn't one slide to talk about rectal cancer. It's slightly different treatment. A lot of the same general principles apply. Surgery is still a very important part. We're talking about, you know, a cancer here in the rectum, the distal part of the colon. The important key thing about this is really an anatomical sort of issue in that Dr. Schultz might laugh at me, but I always think of it as the colon is kind of up in the belly. It's up in the peritoneum. It's kind of flopping around a bit. It's not fixed outside of, you know, kind of you know, at the corners kind of thing. But once you get down in the rectum, it's down behind the peritoneum, which is the lining of this abdominal cavity, the peritoneal lining, and it's sort of in the bottom of a big bowl, your pelvis, and there's a lot of this stuff around, and it's fixed in a place. Why that is important is that cancer grows, and it can invade through the wall of the rectum, and it's much more proximal to a lot of other stuff. And so the key thing about rectal cancer is not only do we worry about it spreading to other organs like the liver or lung, it also can spread to the stuff that's right next door. And so there's a higher risk of what we call local recurrence, cancer coming back in the neighborhood, but not in the lymph nodes, compared to colon cancer. Why that's important is that we treat a little differently, and we often will give a combination of radiation and chemotherapy, typically actually up front, before any surgery, in part to help lower the risk of having that local recurrence, but also to help facilitate surgery when it's time to remove that tumor. It shrinks it down, kind of regresses it away from all the other stuff, you know, the bladder, the uterus, depending where it is, all those kind of things. And it makes it easier to get around it. It makes it easier to, an important part is also is if it's really close to the anus, it can affect the muscles that regulate being a continent, a stool, being able to go to the bathroom. And so you want to be able to get around it so that people can then be reconnected and don't have to have a colostomy where they have, you know, have to have a bag, basically. So that's the idea behind rectal cancer, the one key thing that changes is that we do give chemotherapy in combination with radiation, typically before surgery. Then they have surgery, and then we often will give chemotherapy after surgery for the same reason we give it in colon cancer, to increase the chances they don't have a recurrence, that they don't develop a metastatic lesion. Now, finally, let's talk about stage 4 cancer. And when we talk about stage 4 cancer, we're talking about a colon cancer that started somewhere in the colon, got to the lymph nodes, or maybe just to the bloodstream, and those cells figured out how to travel. Common places colon cancer tends to go is the liver, because most of the blood supply, the colon, goes through the liver. It's a big filter, and so a common place it'll show up is the liver, but it has the potential to go to the lung. It can go to lymph nodes that are not outside of the neighborhood, up in the neck or in the chest. It can invade into the abdominal wall. I've seen it show up in the ovary. But those are all possible sites. Those cells have learned to travel. We typically and traditionally have thought of it as incurable. You know, I think some of that is starting to evolve in really over the last 5-10 years. We know that patients who have limited metastatic sites will live a long time with very aggressive treatment. And a long time can mean to the point where we think maybe cured. But that often requires sort of the kitchen sink approach, and that we often will treat these patients with a combination of chemotherapy, surgery, and then even ablative treatments. And I'll kind of go through some of that. And the primary goal is to, most importantly, to extend a patient's life, but also palliate symptoms depending, we often very much individualize this treatment depending on, you know, the clinical situation picture, their overall health, and, you know, goals that we talk about with the patient. Really, systemic treatment is a cornerstone of treating stage 4 colon cancer. The cancer's already figured out how to travel in the bloodstream. It's already gone to other places. We can see it on the scan, but we know even the spots that you can see on the scan, that there's probably spots you can't see that are too small. And so we really need to give them treatment that goes to all those spots through the bloodstream. Chemotherapy is still the backbone of that. There are several different chemotherapy agents. I didn't list them up here that are very effective. We use typically that have been shown to be effective. And really, chemotherapy is a key part of treatment. In the stage 4 setting, though, we often will add newer treatments. There are the biologic agents. And these are often agents that target treatment in a different way than traditional agents. They often go against target factors that are important in the growth of these cells and allow them to do the things they shouldn't do. One is the epidermal growth factor receptor. Another is the vascular endothelial growth factor, and then also the receptor for that vascular endothelial growth factor. These agents can be effective by themselves, but they actually are even more effective if we use them in combination with chemotherapy. So we'll use these in combination in patients with stage 4 disease. They improve the efficacy of the treatment, and they actually can really help shrink down those tumors. And a couple of these have been really important. Some of these, we've also gotten to the point where we also know that some of the genetic makeup of the actual tumors will dictate how we decide which to use these agents. For example, patients who have mutations in a gene called KRAS or a BRAF will not respond to these EGFR inhibitors. And so we can use those things to help guide our treatment. There's some other agents that also have been developed. Some of these are similar to, but a different sort of mechanism. Regorafenib is an agent used in stage 4 colon cancer as a single agent. It's a tyrosine kinase inhibitor, which is our doctors speak to say that while these other medications target the actual protein through an antibody, this, it blocks the signal. It blocks how the protein signaling happens. It's a pill. This is sort of but it is kind of, you know, how we often talk describe it because it makes it easy. And this aflibercept is even more complicated. It's a recombinant fusion protein that sort of sucks up all the vascular endothelial growth factor ligand, the stimulating proteins. And so, but these are all sort of exciting biologic therapies. The one other thing that I didn't put up here, which has been on all the news for a lot of other cancers, is immunotherapy. Immune therapy is starting to be studied in colon cancer. It's not as effective as it is in other cancers like lung cancer, melanoma, but a certain subtype of patients who have certain characteristics of the tumor will respond well to immune therapy. And that's really a treatment that helps turn on the immune system to help treat the cancer. That being said, it is not, most patients with colon cancer, it hasn't really panned out to be real successful, so in part. Now, we don't always use just the chemotherapy, and as I mentioned earlier, we also will, especially in folks that have limited disease, we'll treat them with a combination of surgery and local therapy in combination with their chemotherapy. Surgery, if you sometimes to remove the tumor, the primary tumor in the colon, but also maybe a spot in the liver, a spot in the lung. We also sometimes will do other localized treatments such as radiation, which is stereotactic radiation, which Dr. Hardenberg at the Shaw is a specialist in this, and this is doing very focal radiation into a spot. There's also radioembolization, which is actually an interventional procedure where they actually put a catheter into the vein or artery of the liver, and I guess it's the, I don't know for sure, but they basically put little beads that are radioactive and supply it directly to the tumor, sort of a localized radiation to tumor lesions. And that's been shown to be effective in patients who have stage 4 disease with liver mets, metastases. There's also other ways, all really the idea being to try to ablate the cancer if you can't cut it out. You can use radio waves to sort of ablate it. It kind of heats it up to and kills the tumor. You can inject alcohol, acetic acid, or freeze it. I mean, these are all kind of permutations of the same idea of trying to ablate lesions, whether they're in the liver. It sometimes can be done in the lung as well. Some sites will use this hepatic arterial chemotherapy, which is the idea if you have liver disease to give chemotherapy just to the liver. It requires having a pump that's sort of inside your abdominal cavity. It's quite complicated, and there's only a few centers across the country that are doing that, so it's not as well studied. So, you know, that's sort of my talk about treatment. Just to switch gears a little bit, I was going to talk a little bit about prevention, but the reality is I think Dr. Schultz touched on this, and Mel's really going to talk about some of these things. I think, you know, what we hope is to hopefully prevent people from developing cancer and not having to see me. But we think that, you know, probably the key thing is screening and finding these cancers earlier and curing them with polypectomies or colonoscopy. But we do know other factors can play a role. I think Dr. Schultz mentioned that physical activity is important. We see up to a 25% reduction in risk of colon cancer in patients who are active versus those who are more sedentary. You know, diet's an important role. I'll let Melaine talk about that. Vitamins, there's maybe some influence, things like folic acid and calcium, vitamin D. A lot of these are somewhat equivocal, but another issue. Dr. Schultz did talk about the aspirin and NSAIDs, and these have been studied. Most of the studies have been observational studies where, you know, they've looked at a bunch of patients. There's, you know, like the Nurses Health Initiative, Physicians Health Initiative, where they looked at patients. They were taking aspirin. Maybe they were taking aspirin for other reasons, and they noticed that there was a decreased incidence of colon cancer in those patients. The randomized studies are a little bit less clear. When you're talking about doses, some of those studies used an 81 milligram dose, which is the dose you use for prevention of heart attacks, the low dose. But in other adenoma polyp studies, they used very high doses of doses up to like 600 milligrams, which is basically two full-strength aspirin. As Dr. Schultz mentioned, those when you start to see especially those higher doses, you increase the risk for having complications from that. So I think how my takeaway from it is that, you know, if you have another reason to take a baby aspirin, you have a, you know, heart disease or other factors that you're taking a baby aspirin, it's probably going to provide some benefit lowering your risk for colon cancer. I don't know that going out and taking a baby aspirin, that would be the primary reason to take it, i.e. to reduce your colon cancer risk. But if there's other reasons, it may be reasonable to do that. I would say that they've done studies looking at taking an aspirin in cost-effectiveness studies, and it's much more effective to go get your colonoscopy than to take your aspirin. So that's sort of the take of what I got for that. So it's not, you know, well, it's easier to take an aspirin than to go through a PrEP. At least you only have to do it every 10 years, right? So there's been some question about is there a benefit of other medications, you know, with postmenopausal hormone therapy. I'm a breast cancer doc too, so I usually, you know, talk hormones bad. But so the evidence isn't real conclusive for any of these, really. That you can find a study that can support it as a prevention, or at least may lower the risk. Another study that didn't show a benefit. Statins are the agents that many of these are used to. These are used to lower cholesterol levels. Bisphosphonates used to treat osteoporosis. ACE inhibitors are blood pressure medications. But these are all in some observational studies, not randomized studies, have some lowering of risk, but not something we would go out and need to start because you want to lower your risk for colon cancer. And I think that's it. So I'll let Mel take over, and I think we'll be around for questions too. So if you, all right, thanks.
Okay, testing, right? All right. So my name's Melaine Hendershott. I'm the registered dietitian at the Shaw Cancer Center. Like Michael said, I've been there about 12 years, and it's just my absolute pleasure to talk to you guys about our favorite luncheon topic, your bowels, right? So, you know, what better way than to show you a little bit, practice what you preach a little bit, in that living a healthy lifestyle is a huge part of preventing not just colorectal cancer, but cancer in general. So, you know, kind of these are the factors that increase the risk of colorectal cancer, lifestyle factors specifically. Dr. Schultz talked a little bit about red meat and processed red meat, which make this statement a convincingly increased risk. So really high evidence there. Alcoholic drinks I'll talk about, as well as body fatness, BMI, and specifically, if you hold it like an apple, that puts you at increased risk. So the good news, kind of decreased risk, what you can do is physical activity, we've talked about some, foods containing fiber, garlic, calcium, and then I'll touch on some, maybe some other things that we've talked about too that just need a little bit more research to know for sure. All right, so first, the bad news, right? So limiting red meat, the current recommendations are to limit to 18 ounces a week or less. So I still think that's a pretty high amount. This is nearly 3 ounces every day that it's recommended. Further, sort of taking one step further, is on average, they want Americans to really be eating 11 ounces. So across the whole board, when it comes to health recommendations, so maybe move more towards that if you're worried about colon cancer. And processed red meat, I feel like this needs a general surgeon warning. I mean, this is, people ask me all the time, what's the worst thing I can eat? And right here. So I quote, there is no safe level of consumption that increasing these or eating these kinds of foods doubles your risk. And these are like your hot dogs, deli meats, bacon, sausage, anything that has added preservatives like nitrates, been smoked, cured. So I got my little cured meats leaving the hospital, and they're not so cured, okay? But it also increases risks of heart disease, diabetes, stroke. I mean, this is just really, really bad stuff. So for alcohol, for you men, this is a higher risk than for you women, but there's risk factors for both sexes. And really, you just want to stick with that moderate intake of not overly indulging and, you know, so no more than 2 a day for the men, and no more than 1 a day for us ladies. And I gave you the serving sizes here. You know, I had a patient this morning who told me that at the bar he has his one glass of wine that is a whole bottle will fit into. And by reducing his intake recently, he's lost 5 pounds in the last week. So, you know, he's been trying to lose some weight for his health and fighting his cancer. So this is good. So it's 5 ounces, not the whole bottle in your one giant glass. Okay, so body weight. So it's very important that you know what your body mass index is. This is a pretty regular anthropometric measure that your doctor knows and that you get classified as being underweight, healthy weight, overweight, obese, or morbidly obese. And so if you are in this obese class, then you have a convincing increased risk of developing colorectal cancer. It also puts you at other cancer risks like breast cancer and endometrial cancer. When it comes to classification of all the cancers, the number one thing you can do is maintain a healthy weight. So it really is important, and especially if you carry that abdominal fat, sort of apple shape, then that's important to try to lose that. And so the good news is that if you lose weight in adulthood, you decrease your risk. So even if you're like thinking, oh, you know, I'm already overweight or I'm already obese, it's too late for me. Nope, it's not. It's good. You can still lose weight. But also, if you avoid weight gain as you're going through life, then that can really reduce your risk as well. So kind of one of my assessment questions I ask my patients most often if they're wanting to lose weight or they're overweight is, what was your weight when you graduated high school? And so if they've been overweight their whole life, then they'll, you know, I'll get that answer. If they were a healthy weight and gained weight in adulthood, then I see that increased risk. But I also know it's realistic for them to lose weight. And even if they had childhood obesity, it's realistic for them to lose weight, but it might be more challenging. So physical activity, we talked about a few different numbers. This is the one that I had. But for those that were the most active compared to the least active, this was in men, had really high fitness levels, was a 38% decreased risk. Really recommend that you move every day, 30 to 60 minutes, heart rate elevated, at least 10 minutes. That's kind of your exercise definition. And so it's okay if you just do a few minutes at a time, at least 10 minutes at a time. But if you don't move, just move. Do something. All right. Eating fiber. Where does fiber come from? What is it in? It's only in plants. You're not going to find it in eggs. You're not going to find it in milk. You're not going to find it in steak, even though the cow ate the plants, okay? You're not going to find it in those foods. It's only in plants that you eat. So I heard nuts. I heard fruits and vegetables, grains, beans, legumes, right? So for every 10 grams of fiber that you eat, you decrease your risk of colorectal cancer by 10%. And so the highest amount of fiber, the least amount of risk, all right? So when they did studies in African children to look at their colon, because African Americans are higher risk of colorectal cancer, in the United States, African Americans compared to Africans, that the children could produce a bowel movement on request. All right, so that's 90% of them could do that, all right? So that's the kind of fiber they were having in their diet, close to 60 grams a day. All right, so we also see a lot of benefit by replacing not just high fiber diet, but also replacing those calories from animal foods with plant foods. So not only are you increasing the fiber in your diet, but you're also decreasing animal foods. And that showed a lot of benefit in reducing risk. So this was a Seventh-day Adventist study. Seventh-day Adventist populations are known for not drinking, not smoking, being mostly vegetarian. And so they took a large population and studied them for a while, and they subgrouped them into vegetarians, meat eaters, vegans, and pescatarians, where they eat fish. And they saw that being vegetarian benefited 22% decreased risk compared to the meat eaters, and when they ate a few servings of fish a week, it was a 43% reduced risk was the best benefit in that study. But even the meat eaters, since they ate meat significantly less than standard American diet, even they were saying that population probably had a lower risk of colorectal cancer by around 30% from the general population's diet. All right, so one easy way to kind of think about your plate is using the MyPlate method, which about half of your plate is fruits and vegetables, and then about another quarter of your plate is whole grains, and then you have a little quarter on your plate that's proteins, which could be from plant proteins like nuts and seeds and beans, but it could also be chicken or fish or something like that. But really filling your plate mostly with plants and then trying to reduce and exchange for some of the animal protein that you're taking in with plants. So meatless Mondays are a great thing, something like that. So we don't really have a recommended daily allowance of fiber from the FDA, but you know, 25 grams a day for women, 30 a day for men. And this really is just because men eat more calories than women. It's not going to hurt for you to eat more than that. So, all right. So what role does fiber play in our GI tract? All right, I need a couple of people. Dr. Schultz, you get your favorite end, and Alice. Maybe you want to go farther over. How long is our room? Okay, so here we have energy in. The average GI tract is 25 feet in length. Okay? Whoa. Michael Holton's probably 35 feet. But, and we start out by eating our meal, and so it sits in our stomach as kind of a bolus, right? And so the average time it sits around is about 2 hours in the stomach, all right? And the role that fiber plays in the stomach is that it helps, you can see in my picture here, it really helps fill you up. So it's great for weight control, it makes you feel fuller longer, but it also is important in slowing down the gastric emptying so that food doesn't enter your small intestines so quickly that your blood sugars spike, and when your blood sugars spike, it causes all kinds of inflammatory cascades that can cause problems. And so that's the important part in the, I'm gonna do the limbo, in the stomach. So in the small intestine, fiber also does not enter your bloodstream. It stays right here in this 25 feet of GI tract. So it leaves your stomach and it kind of travels around for a few hours, all right? So in this time, it's going to get mixed up in your pancreatic enzymes, your digestive enzymes, and your bile that helps emulsify fats and get absorbed into the bloodstream so that you can use those calories that you consumed at that meal for energy. So it's gonna go to your vital organs and tissues that are important for life, all right? But fiber plays a very important role in your small intestine. It starts entrapping cholesterol. So, you know, you hear the commercial of, oh, I lowered my cholesterol with Cheerios or whatever. So that's the fiber, that oat fiber that's in the Cheerios, is entrapping the cholesterol in your GI tract so that it goes out to Dr. Schultz. And then, all right? And so it also helps entrap fats and sugars and slow their absorption. So again, you don't get those big spikes. You get the exact nutrients that you need in the time that you want it to be. So then we get to what we're here all about, our colon, large intestine, right? So you can see this is where the bulk of our food or waste really developed at this point is sitting at the very end. And fiber plays so many roles down here in the way of reducing your risk for colon cancer. So when it gets down there, that's where all your happy, good bacteria live. So when you talk about taking probiotics or taking prebiotics, which are what feeds the good bacteria, then that's, you're trying to get them to go from taking them in all the way down to here, okay? And so fiber is their favorite food. So once they get down to the large intestine, then they just start having a whole feeding frenzy and ferment the fiber in your diet, and it produces a really fantastic fatty acid called butyrate. And butyrate is very important for balancing your dying colon cancer cells with developing your new healthy ones And if there is any cancerous cells, it helps inhibit their growth. And so it makes those good bacteria very happy, and it makes your colon very happy because your good bacteria is feeding your colon cells the right things. It also speeds things along. So if you have your trash can in your kitchen and you cooked some fish, how long do you want that fish waste sitting around in your kitchen before it gets really nasty? So you really want to move that waste out of your body as fast as possible. So has anyone ever soaked beans? Okay, so if you soak beans, they about double in size, you know, over the course of 4 to 8 hours. Then you cook them, and they become soft but formed. So that's what fiber does down there. So you have all this waste that enters in as liquid. The large intestine starts sucking up all that liquid back into your bloodstream to recycle, like your electrolytes and all these beneficial things, but also you don't want to oversuck, right? You don't want to be like sucking out too much water. So the fiber in your colon holds on to just enough water to speed things along and come out in a regular time and be soft but formed, all right? So that's how that works. It also helps to eliminate that waste more quickly, so you avoid more DNA changes in the colon. And it lowers stool pH. So the lower your pH, the more acidic the environment, the higher the pH, the more alkaline the environment. And when it comes to your colon, you want it to be more acidic. When it comes to other things, you want it to be more alkaline, like your urine, you want it to be more alkaline. But plants just so happen to lower the pH when it really comes down to this fiber and resistant starches. And I'm not going to talk a lot about resistant starches because that's like a 20-minute topic. But resistant starches are kind of fun because they're like the new fiber, been more recently discovered, especially when African diets went from more whole grains to more refined grains, but their colorectal cancer risk was still extremely low. It's developed when you do things like cook your potato and then you cool it and make potato salad. It's developed during that cooling process, but resistant starches, your colon happens to love those. So you might Google those because they're kind of fun. Animal protein raises your pH. So you can see where replacing plants and fiber can help reduce your risk, and eating animal proteins will increase your risk just from this pH balance. And then if you change over to more plant-based, you'll see these pH effects in less than 2 weeks. So it happens relatively quickly, and eating one bad meal in the same instance can cause problems, even though cancer in general, it causes problems over a time period, not just one meal. All right, awesome, thank you guys. We'll put our GI tract down for now. All right, so these were mentioned a little bit. Garlic, I mean, this one little allium-filled vegetable is potent. Okay, you're talking about a teaspoon, right, or half a teaspoon clove. It's a 50% reduced risk, one clove a day. So if you can try to get garlic into your diet on a daily basis, this is significant risk reduction. Supplements, not shown to be quite as good.
Is it cooked or not cooked?
Well, I mean, that's a good question. When I looked it up, it was really insignificant with the, you know, how you ate it. If you can handle it raw, God bless you. So, if your spouse can handle it, Rob. Okay. Calcium, there is a little less evidence, for example, than the processed red meat, which is convincing evidence, but having supplements, 812 milligrams a day, again, is kind of like with the aspirin, where they were seeing people taking calcium for other reasons, maybe, and they had less risk, but approximately 30% to 40% reduced risk. And with foods high in calcium, like dairy products, there really wasn't a difference, so that's why I put the supplements specifically. All right, so things that need a little bit more research. This was just kind of a fun one I thought you guys might like. I personally don't drink coffee, but, you know, people ask me, how much coffee is too much coffee? Well, you know, I think the jury's still out. Some studies really showed no decreased risk, but, you know, if you drink it, then maybe you can feel good about it at least. vitamin D, so normal blood levels, you know, showed a 50% reduced risk. If you have a higher blood level, it was better risk improvement. And but these are not really well-defined studies. We're seeing 4 placebo-controlled large population studies, and we should be seeing some of those preliminary results coming out later this year, so watch your headlines for that, with vitamin D supplementation and cancer risk. So happens to be right now is a great time to go get your blood levels checked, because in Colorado we don't make vitamin D between November and April. We just don't have the rays of the sun that hit us properly, nor do we have a lot of skin exposed here in Vail. So, and so right now is a great time to go, because your blood levels will be at their lowest, so you'll really know if you need supplementation to be maintaining these kinds of blood levels, or if, you know, what you've been doing, you do store it pretty effectively, so some people can store it from their summer times all the way through. But, you know, the other doctor, Jean Urquhart, is not here, but, you know, sun exposure is how we make vitamin D. And you really only need about 10 minutes a day. If you can get 40% of your body exposed, that's even better without sunscreen, but then I really recommend that you apply your sunscreen and maybe take your supplements instead. All right, so this is another kind of fun one, so sleep. One study had, if you don't get enough sleep, then it increases your risk of colorectal cancer. But if you sleep a whole bunch and you're obese or you snore, then you're really in bad shape. You really increase your risk. But then if you sleep less than 5 hours, you really decrease your risk. So, or didn't increase your risk. So, you know, more research. So in conclusion, you can really significantly impact your colon cancer risk, colorectal risk, even your overall cancer risk by doing key things. So really watching your weight, healthy diet, regular physical activity, alcohol in moderation, switching out animal foods for more plant foods is very important. So to let you know what you think on yourself. So do you exercise 30 minutes most days? Do you limit red meat and avoid processed red meat? Do you limit your alcohol intake? Do you know your BMI? Is it in a healthy range? Are you a super pooper? then if you answered yes to all of these questions, Well, Dr. Schultz will tell you your average risk. But you've really impacted your risk. If you said no to some of these questions, then maybe change your diet and your lifestyle to reduce your risk. Thank you for your time and attention.